My name is Pamela Waltonspiel, and I live in the city of Santa Rosa in Northern California. In November of 1996, California voters passed Proposition 215, the Medical Marijuana Initiative. Proposition 215 ensures that seriously ill Californians have the right to obtain and use marijuana for medical purposes. Several years later, I myself became a medical marijuana patient. I work within the California legal system, and once I had become a patient, I noticed that other patients and their caregivers were still being subjected to arrest and prosecution, even though Proposition 215 clearly states that patients and their caregivers are not subject to criminal prosecution. This did not sit well with me, and I decided to do something about it. I have a friend named Joe Cable, who has a public access TV show here in Santa Rosa, which he produces out of a small studio in his home. I approached him about helping me create a documentary to mark the 5-year anniversary of the passage of Proposition 215. I knew that if I could get him to agree, my dream of exposing the injustices being perpetrated on these innocent patients in the name of the law would become a reality.
You want us to make a documentary about what?
Proposition 215, the Medical Marijuana Initiative. It's been almost 5 years since it passed, and I want to show how it's helped so many people since then. It could be truly moving.
I don't know, Lady Pamela. A documentary is a lot of work. A lot. I just don't know if I have the time.
Hey, it's not like you're working or anything.
That's true. Still,
just say you'll consider it.
Okay, look. Who are you planning on interviewing? My video setup is pretty basic, so we'll need some strong content to offset our technical limitations. Exactly whom do you have in mind?
First, we can interview Doc Knapp. He's a spokesperson for the Sonoma Alliance for Medical Marijuana. He can provide some background information on Prop 215, and he might know some patients we can interview about how much medical marijuana has helped them.
A physician faced with a patient with whatever, ongoing pain, they're going to be on medication for life or for years. They look at their treatment options. You know, they have aspirin and they have Tylenol and they have codeine, morphine, and they have all these drugs that they can use in the example of pain. The problem, as the physician sees it, is every one of those drugs creates problems. Every one of them. You know, 106,000 people die each year from prescription medications. 1 million are hospitalized. 1,000 people or more die from aspirin each year, and aspirin's a safe drug. No one in recorded history has ever died from cannabis. So if you're a doctor and you're looking to provide the safest medication you can, the choice becomes pretty obvious.
I don't know. I just don't see much of a story there. A bunch of talking heads extolling the virtues of weed isn't exactly gripping video.
Yes, I mean, it has various benefits. The most well-known, of course, are its effects in relieving nausea, particularly for people who are undergoing chemotherapy or radiation, or who have nausea for other conditions. It also is very useful for people who suffer from a lack of appetite or anorexia, you know, whether it's anorexia nervosa or other causes of anorexia, because it stimulates the appetite, causes the munchies.
We'll need something a little more substantial to hang it on. After you've shown one patient saying how they wouldn't be alive today without medical marijuana, and how much better their lives are now that it's legal in California, you're pretty much finished. All the other patient testimonials will just be retreads.
Some of the conditions which are specified in Prop 215 are migraines, and arthritis, spastic conditions, chronic pain. But it has other uses as well. And certainly for most people who use it, it relieves anxiety.
We'll need some kind of conflict to hold people's interest. That's where the real drama is.
So under Proposition 215, ostensibly a medical patient who has a recommendation or approval from their physician for using it for a serious illness, or one of the illnesses that are enumerated in 215, can legally possess and cultivate and use cannabis for the medical condition.
In California, the voters have decided that marijuana use should be legal when supervised by a physician. And since it was done this way, we urge physicians in general to be open to the idea of recommending marijuana to their patients.
If there is a documentary in here, it's got to be in the conflict of the state versus the individual. Because nobody else can screw you as badly as the state can screw you. You need to get us interviews with some people who have been caught up in the cogs of the machine and are being slowly ground into submission. Everybody roots for the underdog, you know. Then, maybe, we'll have something.
Okay, I'll make some phone calls. So, are we on then?
Under those conditions, yes, we're on.
Excellent.
My own personal case with muscle spasms and pain being an ongoing thing for the last decade and a half, I was on the regular treatment regimen, muscle relaxer, anti-inflammatory. The problem was that it took a toll on the body. You know, it had serious gastric complications from that. And then also because of other medical conditions that I've had where I've been on high doses of medications for a number of years, my liver got saturated with pharmaceutical medications. I could no longer take them. There wasn't a choice for me anymore. And fortunately, we have, medical cannabis that just does the job as well or better.
Nature's analgesic.
Right, and I'm not worried about my liver enzymes spiking. Right.
Hey, it's not boring.
Well, it's not exactly burning up the screen, if you know what I mean.
The testimonials are important. They clearly show the obvious benefits of medical marijuana, and they get people used to your funky jump cut editing style.
But it's popular with the kids.
The testimonials stay in.
Started getting involved with cancer at age 23. I'm 47 now. And so it's been 24 years that I've been doing the survivor game with the malignant metastatic issues and the repeated surgeries. I've been getting whittled on and electrocuted and poisoned and burned here throughout the years. And I didn't need marijuana years and years and years, decades and decades ago when I first got involved with this stuff. And my history was very conservative, very Republican. I volunteered for the military during Vietnam. I served as a combat law enforcement patrolman in the Air Force. And I was, a Boy Scout.
And I think it's one thing that never gets portrayed in the media is how serious these illnesses are. All you ever see in the media is people smoking a joint. You never see and you never hear questions asked of patients like, well, What is your daily regimen of using medical marijuana?
If I don't have this, spasticity comes from my right brachial plexus was electrocuted in surgery, and there's scar tissue directly on the nerve pathways. And so without the medicine, I start going around looking like something like this, constantly in pain, unable to sleep. That's from the repeated surgeries and the nerve damage and the muscle damage.
And the marijuana does relieve the majority of your symptoms.
I would even purport that it keeps cancer away, and at least in what's going on with me, and I haven't had any tumors in 10, 11 years, 12 years, no surgeries. The people who purport to know, that's what they say is happening. I don't know.
It works.
It works. It works pretty darn good.
So I think that's one thing that the media just never portrays is the seriousness of the illnesses and the reality of these people's day-to-day existence.
Are you ready for this? I just got us an interview with Terrence Hallinan, the district attorney for San Francisco.
No way.
Way. His public information guy set it up.
Awesome.
There's just one little catch. I had to tell this PR guy, his name's Fred Gardner, that he could sing his medical marijuana song for us and that we'd use it in the documentary.
Whatever. Wow. The DA of San Francisco is making time to talk to us. This is extremely encouraging.
Isn't it?
Terrence Hallinan is universally recognized as taking the most progressive approach to the implementation of Prop 215 of any district attorney in the state of California. We spoke with him at his office in the San Francisco Hall of Justice.
Well, I endorsed the 215. I was the only district attorney who did, and had an argument in the voter's handbook in favor of it. I believe that that approach to marijuana, that it be available to a person pursuant to a doctor's recommendation, is that at this point a reasonable approach and a reasonable limitation, as a 21-year-old age limit is on alcohol. And I did support medical marijuana. I convened a department heads meeting of the police and the DA and the health department and probation department, courts and other people, and began to work out some guidelines that we could use. That is basically requested the health department to do that, and the health department since then has done a terrific job. I understand they have about 4,000 cards that they've issued here in San Francisco. They have a picture and a number on it, and they verify the doctor's recommendations. They do a good job, and the clubs basically use the city health card as the criteria for coming in and out of the club, so that it's we're sure that it's being done properly and legally, and medical marijuana is made available to patients in San Francisco.
We also spoke with Chris Conrad, the author of several books about marijuana and our legal system. Chris has testified as a cannabis expert in over 50 cases involving medical marijuana.
I have investigated in excess of 100 cases. I've testified in excess of 50 cases. I have qualified in 23 counties in the state of California, plus the federal...
Qualified as an expert within...
Within the legal terminology of it, yes. Cannabis expert.
For 23 counties.
Plus the federal district.
You're legally recognized as knowing what you're talking about in this particular area.
Yes.
Now we're getting somewhere.
I agree.
Let's face it, I'm not a medical marijuana patient, so it's not a personal issue for me. But I think the legal angle is pretty interesting. That and the conflict between the state and the federal government.
Although medical marijuana is now legal in California, it is still considered a dangerous, illegal drug under federal law.
Do you see a conflict between the federal scheduling and the guidelines?
Oh, no question. Being a Schedule I marijuana and a Schedule I drug means that it has no valid medical purpose. It's in conflict with common knowledge. It was in conflict when they scheduled it originally in that, and it certainly is even more so today, now that so many people have become aware, particularly with AIDS and cancer, that that there's no question glaucoma.
I actually have one of the highest recorded IOP, that's intraocular pressure, for wide-angle glaucoma.
Glaucoma.
In the history of recorded medicine.
Proposition 215 was originally passed as a bill by both houses of the California legislature, only to be vetoed twice by Republican Governor Pete Wilson. Supporters then decided to put it before the voters of California as an initiative.
And so it was decided, let's do an initiative. And so everybody sat down and started working on drafting an initiative. And it was, many people were involved. There were a lot of faxes going back and forth, a lot of people putting their two cents in and changing it here and changing it there. And like, you know, many things that wind up at a committee, it probably had something in it that pleased everyone, and no one was pleased with the whole thing. They wanted an initiative that could fit on one page, that anyone could read very quickly and understand. And if you look at most laws, they're long and they're intricate and they're tough to understand. Of course, a lot of other people would say there's a reason for that. And I think some people who didn't understand that before Prop 215 passed might understand that a little better now that they've seen the problems that have happened because of the way that it's written. There was also a thought by a number of people that once the statute passed, if it did pass, that would send a message to the judges and the DAs and the police, and that they would immediately get that message and understand and seek to interpret and implement the statute in as broad a manner as possible.
As I say, we've managed to keep so far minimum problems. The clubs work well with my office, work well with the police department, and we really haven't had any problems other than those that any kind of new businesses, a few of them have gone broke, few have had problems, a couple robberies, but
nobody's been dragged through the court system like we've seen some of these people.
No, that hasn't happened here.
I disagreed with that faction. That faction outvoted me, essentially. I did not get final say. I felt that the judiciary and the DAs and the police would just view this as a hoax and would seek to narrow it as much as possible.
Our impression of it was that the sheriffs and I, that the statute itself has some terrible flaws because it fails to provide a distribution system for something, a substance that it then attempts to provide to certain people identified as patients or caregivers. And without a distribution system defined in the statute, it was difficult to ascertain how this particular initiative and how you would provide a distribution system in view of federal law, which bans it entirely.
I think as it's played out, I wish I had been wrong, but I think the way it's played out, I was right. That's one of the problems out of the vagueness. The vagueness allows for a lot of different interpretations.
The only manner in which the sheriff and I could conceive of a system to prevent large-scale growths, which I think are dangerous to people, would be to allow people to grow it themselves or their caretaker, assuming that person met the qualification for caretaker. And caretaker, on first blush, for our purposes, appeared to be a one-on-one relationship. One caretaker for one patient.
And essentially, a lot depends on who the DA is, where you get arrested, who the judge is, what kind of people live in the community. And if people call me up and they're arrested for marijuana, and medical marijuana, first question I want to know is, where do you live? Because that's the single most important factor. Not who your lawyer is, not how much you had, not who the doctor is, it's where you live.
Sonoma County was not a real medical marijuana friendly place to begin with, and I think it's become more so as a result of law enforcement understanding better and all of us getting more on the same page with this issue.
But in a lot of ways, it's even more individual than what county. It's which judge, which deputy district attorney, which officer.
Essentially, meddling. Is that still happening here in Sonoma County? That there are still people working against the, you know, the intent of Prop 215?
I don't see any large concerted effort. There's always an individual here and there who doesn't agree and, you know, might want to obstruct.
We began without quantity definitions. relying on the expertise of the narcotics officers to determine what amount of marijuana could be for personal use and what not.
The problem is that for years the police have been trained in the state the cannabis plants will yield, usually the party line is a pound a plant. And then I've heard officers testify outdoor plants will yield 2 to 5 pounds each. And most police officers believe this. And it's entirely untrue.
There's this technique that's widely used around the world. It's called Sea of Green. And the way that it works is that instead of growing one big, large marijuana plant in order to get the usable cannabis flowers off of it, that what people do is they grow a lot of very small plants. And so the difference in that is profound because you can be growing plants in Sea of Green technique, can be spaced one plant every foot. They can be spaced one plant every 8 inches. They can be spaced even one plant every 6 inches. And now if you have a 4x4 space of 16 square feet, that means that you could have 64 plants in there, or 32 plants in there, or 16 plants in there. Or you could even grow one plant in there. But the thing is, there's only enough room to grow this much cannabis.
There's a maximum yield that you'll get out of that.
And the formula is?
And there's an area that you can... Well, there's a formula that was derived by the federal government. The National Institute on Drug Abuse has done an ongoing grow site down in Mississippi since the 1980s at least. And they have come to a formulation of one half of an ounce of usable bud per square foot as the average yield of marijuana.
Do you think that's realistic?
What the government did was they took NIDA's figure of a half ounce per square foot and they combined it with the DEA's figure, which came in roughly an ounce per square foot, and they came up with this formula that comes to about 3/4 of an ounce per square foot. And it works pretty good, yeah. I do agree with those numbers. I think that that's the range.
So what you have often is a situation where somebody has, you know, 100 plants in a 4x4 tray, and the officer's testifying, well, that's going to produce 100 pounds. It's way too much. They're possessing it with the intent to sell. Why would anybody need that much marijuana? When in reality, a 4x4 tray is 16 square feet, and that, no matter how many plants you put in it, is likely to produce approximately half a pound every 3 to 4 months. So now you have, on the one hand, the defendant saying, this is going to produce a half a pound, the police saying, this is going to produce 100 pounds. And then you're arguing, you know, well, half a pound is reasonable, 100 pounds isn't reasonable, but the real problem is that lack of scientific truth about what the yields are.
They told the lady judge on a Sunday, who was a pro-marijuana, medical marijuana judge, they told her that they were certain that I had too much to be growing just for my own use.
I think if anything could be done to help patients, it would be to educate police and for them to be open-minded about what the truth is of what the yield of plants are.
Do you think there's an institutionalized reluctance to do that?
Absolutely.
Buzzy Linhart is a Bay Area musician, best known as the composer of Friends, a top 40 hit for Bette Midler.
That's good.
Karen Ohm on the guitar. Remember when we used to...
Lovely Karen on the guitar.
Buzzy resides in Berkeley, California, where he cultivated medical marijuana for his own personal use. Buzzy's garden was raided by officers of the Berkeley Police Department on September 13th, 1998.
Well, it's been since 63 since I had 10 or 15 cops come in.
Oh, man.
Through every hole, and it's just, it's a bad experience.
Yeah.
They assume that you're very guilty, and somebody had written on the warrant that there was probably LSD and heroin and
crazy stuff,
implements of
it,
destruction,
right?
And just right. Everything. I was morally unfit and everything, you know.
You're heavily so, armed. I just treated similar.
And you only had 11 plants, right?
11 plants.
And wait a minute. Hadn't the police helped us carry them inside the night before?
The night before they helped us.
Because the crack dealers down the street were running through the backyard and tearing limbs off.
Vandalizing.
We called the police, my friends, the evening before at 11:15.
They I was here up. That day, too.
They read
what,
my
what was the exact date? What was the exact date?
September 12th and September 13th, right. 1990.
And September 12th was when they helped to carry the plants.
Saturday, at night. Saturday
into the house. And then the very next day, they just went and got a warrant and came
can
back.
Can you play something in a minor key very slow?
Yeah, somebody got a warrant. Jennifer Hall, officer badge number 24. She was leading this brigade. She had gotten a search warrant, and she had also implied the presence of acid, LSD, that is, psychedelics, and that they should be on the lookout for all sorts of stuff like that, and lists,
I
the
can't
dealer's
take
list, scales, baggies, this such, you know, any kind of hard drugs.
They took but white they, flower oil from Chinatown that my dad sent me.
Yeah.
And claimed it was LSD.
Well, I was going to get to that part.
And, first somebody said, the police are here. And I looked out the window. The window was open, sunny day. And I just saw them coming over the, you know, every point
crawling,
of the...
Crawling,
you know,
like over insects.
The fence. So did they arrest both of you, you
no,
and Buzzy?
I did not get actually arrested.
They handcuffed about five of us.
Outlawed by affiliation.
Right.
But I was handcuffed.
Right.
So when Buzzy went to the backyard to greet those officers, I noticed that at the front door there was another set of officers pounding away. As I approached, somehow they came in. I guess we had just left it unlocked. They entered quite easily, guns drawn, so I put my hands up.
Like
a good kid, and said, hey, we're just peaceful, helping hippies here, and there's no guns, no heavy drugs, it's just medical marijuana, and...
You clearly stated from the beginning that it was...
I said
he clearly stated!
At the beginning, I said...
From the top!
It's medical, officer.
I ain't no crook!
Your buddies were here last night.
My pop.
They helped us out. They helped us move it right inside.
Yeah.
They came at 4:20. They came Sunday 4:20. They knew, I'm sure. They had some idea 4:20 meant something to us.
Yeah.
They're all dressed in their beautiful, beautiful. Some of them had very nice armor on. This impressive display of bravado. And so they ransacked the place while about four or five of us were handcuffed very uncomfortably for hours. One of the housemates at the time had a shoulder injury, was very uncomfortable. Of course, Buzzy has a damaged shoulder. He was handcuffed. They ransacked the place, found, as Buzzy said, some oil, an herbal ointment, and with a little eyedropper, and a gift from Buzzy's now-deceased father, and took that.
Understand the police have been trained for 60 years that marijuana is an evil, dangerous drug. That has no redeeming value whatsoever. Then, overnight, we tell them, oh, no, no, it has medical value. Respect patients. And they're also told, this is BS, just some rich people from back east came who really want to legalize drugs and hoodwink the voters. Many police officers believe us.
We tried, all of us took turns for 45 minutes repeating over and over. We have letters from three of Buzzy's doctors. We have our laminated letters.
You're in compliance with the law.
And
this was
Hall,
98,
this was 98,
right?
Yeah.
And Jennifer Hall was then running on boasting, saying things like, oh, well, you can have it, and you can smoke it, but you can't grow it.
That's right. You're not allowed to cultivate.
You can't grow it. Come
cultivate
on.
Was the word
yeah,
she
cultivate. Yeah, you're right. She was very formal. Yeah. Very
and it says right in 215, ladies and gentlemen, cultivation.
Specifically.
She hadn't studied at all.
My belief is that the patients that I've discussed with are consistent that they want bud, and so I'm not really interested in what the castaways
right.
are. And so I do very strongly go and I look at that, and it affects the ultimate weight that you come up with, and that was important in Buzzy's case, as a matter of fact, because when the police came in here, and I'm speaking from Buzzy's house right now, when the police came in here and raided it, and he had 11 plants, and they estimated what they thought this yield was going to be, they were including unusable parts of the plants. And then they created this very inflated idea of this value that it had, and therefore inferred that it must be for commercial purposes because it had all this value. And the fact of the matter is, they were putting value on two things that have no value. The first is waste products of the plant, like the old leaf that you, the that no one is going to use. It's just used basically for compost. So they were counting all that, and they were counting this imaginary pot that they thought he was going to get.
They go crazy over it. It was 6 months before the detective who ran the thing leveled with the DA, from what I can see, leveled with the DA and the prosecutor, and told him, well, yeah, he did have his medical marijuana papers. I mean, when they took it from me, it said green laminated card. It didn't say proof of his right to utilize medical marijuana under 215. It was giant.
Buzzy was arrested and taken to jail. The officers confiscated most of his medicine, and he was not allowed access to it while in their custody.
I got glaucoma, and if I don't, the doctor says every 2 hours, because marijuana decreases in the system very quickly. And because of that, I have to smoke every 2 hours, and I'm supposed to get up and smoke once in the night at least. And twice if possible.
And did they book you and print you in the whole nine yards?
Are you serious? Of course they did. They couldn't even find a bed for me in 32 hours.
They wouldn't let him take his wheelchair.
They wouldn't.
Oh, man, that's cold.
They weren't going to let him take
him home
from jail. Oh, yeah. We were discussing.
I mean, to be in there without.
He should be treated every 2 hours. Yeah. They forced him to go without treatment for
32 hours.
It was horrible.
It's very painful for me.
Second, stress is bad for glaucoma.
When your retina's tearing, there can be a pain to it.
Yeah, there's also it's called optic migraine. When the pressure rises to a certain point, there's too much pressure on the optic nerves, and that creates a migraine
pain,
from that source, and it's very uncomfortable. And
it's been so bad to me. I've been in denial, man.
Because you're going to have friends. You're going to have friends.
William G. Panzer, one of the experts on cannabis law.
Guy who helped draft the 215.
And helped to draft Proposition 215.
Right. We called it Bill
that
way.
So Bill responded very quickly and appeared in court there Monday morning and was able to get Buzzy released on his own recognizance. We did not have to post bail. We were able to step forward with lots of help and lots of assistance.
And so they finally let you go. But they kept evidence that they
So that was Monday morning, and they had to drive them all the way back to Santa Rita.
In the bus with the murderers.
Oh, man.
The bus with all the murderers and everything. And still, no wheelchair. He has to get up, climb out of things with hands.
Standing up and down is the problem.
Again, and it's just an unfair treatment to a sick person. And we had identified him as such from the very beginning. It's just unfair treatment.
You know, the most astonishing thing is that this happened to Buzzy in Berkeley. I mean, Berkeley, for crying out loud.
It's pretty unbelievable, all right.
Although all charges against him were dropped, all of Buzzy's medical marijuana had been allowed to spoil while in the possession of Berkeley police. Buzzy then sought legal restitution from the city of Berkeley. The city refused to settle the case, and a trial date was set.
Let me say now, remember the night before they settled, at 9 o'clock, they called my lawyer and said, you better take it, $7,500. And my guy said, well, I think he's nuts, but my client wants to go to the block, man. We want to go right up there, and I want to meet a jury, and we want to talk about it. And you know, the next morning, we got a call at 9:01 saying that we had a $30,000 check waiting for us.
$30,000.
Although I was dismayed by the details of Buzzy's arrest and treatment, I was further surprised by the even greater persecution of medical marijuana patients taking place in my home county of Sonoma.
And my lawyer, Sandy Feinlin, sent them a letter, and Detective Brown did give me a phone call. He gave me a 20-minute investigative phone call and asked me a whole bunch of questions. Some of them very personal and private about my medical stuff. And finally, after 20 minutes, he relented and said, go ahead and grow. You know, I said, look, I'm just a disabled veteran. I got cancer. I'm all beat up and scarred and twisted and poisoned up. And, you know, I just need this medicine. And finally, I said, go ahead and grow. And he got off of this investigation thing.
They gave you an official go-ahead.
Verbal.
In spite of the fact that local law enforcement knew he was a registered patient, Sonoma County Sheriff's deputies raided Allen's home on the 21st of May, 1999. All of his plants were seized and destroyed.
apparently I was under surveillance. They had known that I went out to get the morning paper, and they were just waiting for me to come back. Sat down and started to read it and got into about a page or two. And then there was a knock at the door after I saw shadows moving across the front window. Mm. Opened the door, and on the other side of the screen, says, I'm Deputy Gordon of the Sonoma County Sheriff's Department, and I'm here with a search warrant. Are you growing marijuana?
Now they knew you were growing marijuana because you'd informed them that that was the case.
My contention is that they knew perfectly well who I was and what was doing.
Right.
And they had me under surveillance for a whole year. But his gig was that he didn't know anything about it. There was a change in the sheriff's department personnel. Nobody told him. He was all just being...
Right. He was unaware of your medical marijuana status.
Yeah, so they here they were. They come in there. They turn me around. They handcuff me behind my back. They make me sit down on a chair. And then they start questioning me, and I tell them that I want my lawyer present, and they ignore that, and they said, are you growing marijuana? I said, no, I'm growing medical marijuana, and then I told them about Detective Brown and being investigated, and here was my letters, and I had to go in there backwards and sit down and go find the letters and give it to them, and he looked at the letters, my medical letter, and the letter from my lawyer to Mr. Mullins, the Sheriff Pacini, and he laughed, and he said, these are forgeries, you're lying, and I just seemed like a whole big song and dance, a big show.
Did they confiscate your plants that first time?
They didn't. They destroyed them all, and I didn't have any other medical marijuana in the house with me. The house was empty. But that was the first time they put me into custody. After about 6 hours, they told me bail was set at $10,000.
Ouch!
If I had $10,000, I could get out and have my medicine immediately. But because I had no money, I had to wait to see a judge. That was a weekend of arrest. Took me in on Friday. 2.5 days of solitary confinement.
Not to mischaracterize anybody, but do you think maybe they busted you on the weekend just so they could sit your ass in the can?
I'd have to say so, yeah. It was all well thought out, and I think...
I mean, it does happen. People are picked up just before the weekend so that they really don't have any recourse.
Well, my prejudice is that they really didn't want to prosecute me. They wanted to arrest me. They wanted to take my medicine away from me. They wanted to harass me. They wanted to hound me. They wanted to put me under the thumb of the threat of prosecution to get me to not do it, to find it more difficult. And I volunteered for this. There's other patients that if they did this and the cops grabbed them, it would kill them or definitely shorten their life. I was one of the stronger ones. And then Judge Hardcastle himself moved me to OR and removed the medical marijuana prohibition. And he did not say, go ahead and have your medical marijuana out. He just said, you're no longer prohibited from having it.
Oh, sweet.
And then I was back to OR, on recognizant. I was innocent until proven guilty. I was already defending 77 plants. So I got some more plants and started cultivating them and trying to get another bit of medical marijuana that I could put in my medicine cabinet.
On the 31st of August, 1999, Allen was again raided by Sonoma County Sheriff's deputies. Once again, all of his medical marijuana was confiscated and destroyed.
I was out on hospice duty.
This is 99 still?
Yeah, it's 2.5 months later. I'm already defending 77 plants. I'm innocent until proven guilty. I'm talking to Judge Hardcastle. I'm dealing with my lawyer. My lawyer's dealing with the DA and the sheriff. The DA knows what's going on. The sheriff comes into him. Wow, we got another bust. DA says, sure, go right ahead. You know, and nobody knows what's going on again. And there's different stories about why they're blessed to meet. One, I'm growing too much again, even though it's fewer plants. I went from 77 plants down to 33.
We did develop guidelines, which are published, allowing police officers to leave a marijuana grow in place if it was determined that the individual was a patient.
And there was my letters. You know, here they are.
And your documentation didn't mean a thing.
No, it was right here. It was all posted all over the place. And it didn't mean a thing. It's like they never even seen it.
Of course, we believe that it was an affirmative defense, meaning the burden's on the person to establish their patient.
McFarland was arrested during two raids on his home in May of 1999. Sheriff deputies discovered 72 marijuana plants, and in August of 99, they found 36 more and promptly uprooted them.
Now, were you on trial for both of those offenses?
Yeah.
At the same time?
Yeah, they also charged me with sales. And I had two sales charges, two cultivation charges.
And did they actually claim that you sold to an officer or something like that?
Well, I was growing too many, and so obviously this has to be for sales.
Right.
I had a 22-year-old BMW that was junked out on my driveway, and I had a little old postage scale meter, scale.
Yeah, I know
in my
what
office.
You're talking about.
And so because I had a postage scale thing, I was winning. And I had BMW, I was rich, and I had 77 plants.
Obviously a dealer.
Obviously a dealer. This is somebody who's on the black market. He's obviously, we don't have to prove anything, just that. That's the evidence, he's a dealer. So that's what they charged me for sales on. And I was, 8 years for the sales, another 6 years for the cultivation.
Now, not to get too personal, but
sure.
What was your state of mind at this time? I mean, what were you thinking when all of this was going on?
They're being nasty and harsh, and I'm just going to have to keep the green flag flying.
You feel like a scapegoat?
In my quieter moments, when I was weaker, yeah.
Well, they were persecuted, after all.
Yeah.
<A little bit.
laughs> But in my stronger moments, I refuse to see myself as a victim. I won't do that. I will not live in fear.
Ken Hayes and Michael Foley were Sonoma County residents who ran a medical marijuana distribution club called CHAMP, Californians Helping to Alleviate Medical Problems, which applied medicine to over 1,200 patients in San Francisco.
To set up a network of patients caring for patients, including myself and Michael Foley included.
And you had the assistance of the district attorney of county in San Francisco in doing so.
I arranged a meeting with the district attorney of San Francisco, Terrence Hallinan, pretty early on because it was important to me to work closely with the local law enforcement because I didn't want to be operating in an environment that was going to be hostile.
When the federal government first began to close down the clubs, I actually went to CHAMP, which by then was run by Ken, and convinced him that he shouldn't close down, that it could be done properly, and explained how it could be done. And I've worked with Ken for several years while he was at CHAMP and then in his new club.
You were operating in an out front and forward manner, in compliance with the law.
Yeah, that's how we got busted because I wasn't hiding anything. I thought what I was doing was legal, and when my neighbor asked me, "What's in the greenhouse?" I said, "Oh, it's some cannabis that I'm growing for the sick and dying people in San Francisco, according to the law."
On the 14th of May, 1999, Ken Hayes' West County home was raided by a county narcotics task force. 899 medical marijuana plants were seized and destroyed.
Did I know they were coming? Nobody called me and told me that they were on their way. I had no indication that they were coming. They knocked on the door, they announced their presence, Sheriff's Department. I was on the phone at the time, and I went and answered the door, and they told me I had to get off the phone that they were there serving a search warrant. And then I needed to put my hands behind my back. They were going to put me in handcuffs. I said, that's fine. Can I see the search warrant? And they said, put your hands behind your back. And I put myself in handcuffs. I said, okay, I'm in handcuffs now. Now can I see the search warrant? My civil rights were definitely violated because I asked about, and it's on audio tape, if I could have a lawyer present. I asked if I was under arrest, and they said no, that I was not under arrest at that time, even though I was in handcuffs. And they try and trick you up by saying, well, you're not technically under arrest. Well, I wasn't free to leave either. So technically, yes, I was being detained, and my Sixth Amendment right attached also. And I didn't really have to talk to them, and I asked for an attorney. So in that respect, I do feel like my civil rights were violated.
Did they, like, take you downtown, book you, lock you up the whole nine yards?
They did indeed, and they put me in jail on a $35,000 bail.
So they make it extremely difficult for you to make. Was this, what day of the week was this?
This was Friday noon, and the way they have it set up, if you don't have any money, and you can't make bail, you have to sit in jail over the weekend for the arraignment.
They busted Alan Filon.
That's their little technique. They know that. They know you're going to have to sit in jail over the weekend. And if nothing else, that's their little punishment to you. They took the plants, they chopped everything down, they left two stubs of plants that were chopped down so far that they ended up dying. And they left the house in shambles, a mess. They tore up everything. They broke open a safe, even though I told them I'd give them access to it. They treated me like I was a second-class citizen.
It was wrong because they manhandled us, and I don't need that. I'm an adult, and would I be...
You're not well.
Well, would I be somebody they respected? They never would have done that. And here's all these guys joining in, man.
Mike, were you there at the time?
No, I wasn't.
So just Ken was present on the day that they made the bust. Now, did they officially arrest you? And
I turned myself in. I was in New Jersey at the time when the house was raided, and I was at my brother's wedding. He was getting married, so I guess I got back a few days later, and then I turned myself in.
Because you knew they were going to come and get you.
Yes. There was actually some delay in the time I was actually charged. I think that was part of it. Initially, they charged Ken. Then the idea was to get Ken to plead to some kind of a deal.
In the beginning, Ken just was charged, and Mr. Mullins offered a deal that if Ken pled to cultivation and a section called 11379.6, which is running a lab, producing controlled substances by chemical process or some such process, generally used for meth labs and PCP labs. Mr. Mullins wanted Ken to plead to that also. It's a potential 7-year sentence, and agreed that if he would do that, he would get no more than a year, and that Mr. Mullins would not charge Ken's partner, Cheryl, or Mike Foley. Everybody stood behind Ken, and so we turned that deal down. Mr. Mullins then went, and when I turned it down, I explained to him that that wasn't even a proper charge, and I gave him all the citations and sections to look at. But he went ahead and charged Mike Foley and charged Cheryl Segarra, and charged them with that statute.
And so somebody else was
Ken's girlfriend.
Yeah, my partner, Cheryl, the mother of my daughter.
Now, did they take her into custody?
They did not take her into custody. They did the same thing with Michael. They turned themselves in to the court, and the court put them on supervised own recognizance, where they had to provide a urine test once a week, was it?
Yes.
So, what do you think?
I think we're definitely getting somewhere. The thing that distinguishes Buzzy's arrest from the others is that they dropped the charges. It never went to trial. Something entirely different is happening here in Sonoma County. And it's starting to look to me like Mike Mullins is the key to this whole thing.
The only issues which go to trial have to do with the patients who are growing their own marijuana, and that has to do with the amount that they're growing. For example, earlier this year, I testified in Crescent City of a trial of a brother and sister who were growing medical marijuana.
for their own use. They had recommendations from another physician, and they were found with, I think, 120 plants, and they were acquitted by the jury. Yes.
The things that stood out the most were the fact that Alan McFarlane seemed to have a very close relationship with his doctor, and his doctor said that Alan McFarlane should be able to smoke as much medical cannabis as he needed to relieve his symptoms.
Dr. Kaiser said something very amazingly insightful on the witness stand when he was defending my life. It's
Do you want to take a minute?
Yeah, please. It's interesting having my doctor come to a court of law to save my life. He said it probably all has to do with all the repeated damages to the nervous system and the carotid and the jugular. I do not have a jugular over here on this side, and half of the carotid is gone. Surgically removed at age 23 along with 9 pounds of tissue and tumor.
A lot of times the people who need someone like me are the people who are really the most serious patients. If a patient really is consuming 6 or 8 pounds a year, 9 pounds a year, 12 pounds a year, someone has to explain that when you eat it, it takes three times as much as
right.
Smoke, for example. A lot of people know that, but how many people can sit in front of a jury with a judge's qualification and explain that? And so that's where I fit into the paradigm of all these. You have the attorneys, you got the prosecutors, you got the patients, you might consider victims actually in most of these cases. But then you've got me. Actually, this ties right back to the Sea of Green question, which Alan was not using a Sea of Green, but he was using something that was comparable. He was growing cannabis in 5-gallon buckets, which have a 12-inch diameter, which when placed together allow 12 inches of area for the plant. And so we were able to look at that size of his garden and calculate with the number of plants that he had there that they would be coming in 1/2 ounce to 3/4 ounce per square foot, as I said earlier. And so county was alleging was because of the number of plants, each of those plants automatically would give him 1/2 pound of marijuana. I think it was 1/2 pound that they were claiming in this case. And he had, because they rated him twice, with once with 70-some and the other time with 40, it ended up with 100-plus plants. And so they were saying he was going to have 50-some pounds.
What was your findings to what his projected amount would have been from that garden?
About 3 pounds. But there were 2 gardens. He would have got about 3 pounds the first time and about 4 pounds the second time, based upon the size of the plants. Mm-hmm.
So
if they had left him alone the first time, he would have had about 1/2 as much as the federal government gives a patient in its program. And I thought that's reasonable for him to have 1/2 as much as the federal government gives a patient,
yeah.
At least.
Which is 6 to 8 pounds.
Right.
Per
he would
year.
Have had 3 pounds. And then the second time, he was trying to grow bigger plants because they had told him that the little plants was the problem.
So you think they maliciously misrepresented the facts in the case in order to secure a conviction against you?
Trying to, yeah.
You don't think they were playing fair?
Mm-mm. And I talking to other people, this is normal, and it's the phrase is they test a lie, they don't testify.
The prosecutors seemed to be attempting to deceive everyone, basically.
So they don't testify, and with my background in combat law enforcement, I find this incredibly reprehensible.
All of her witnesses, it seemed very rehearsed. Like, she had talked to them earlier and said, no, I will ask this and you will answer this, it seemed. And most of her witnesses seemed to be giving a show.
Do you think they were trying extra hard to persuade you because of the lack of any real
because of the lack of a real case to present, that they thought maybe they could just, you know, get you on their side and barrel it right through?
Yeah. And I don't think they really, I guess, knew the extent of how they were getting into, and they discovered that they didn't really have much of a case, and that's what they tried to do.
And that was the whole argument in court. Well, this guy really is a disabled veteran. Yeah, he really did have cancer, and we're really, really sorry about it. And Dr. Kaiser is a really, really great doctor. And Mr. McFarland took advantage of him in the law, and he's abused it, and he's a horrible man, sent him to jail.
Yeah.
A Sonoma County jury has cleared a Santa Rosa man of charges he was growing too much marijuana for his personal medicinal needs. The jury found 47-year-old Alan McFarland innocent of two counts of cultivation of marijuana.
Can you describe the moment when the jury finally acquitted you?
That was powerful. I was waiting for the axe to fall, and the district attorney was out to get me. They were lying. They were staging evidence. They were misstating the law. And the jury came out not guilty for the first medical marijuana charge.
You're now in the clear as far as the legal system is concerned up to this point.
My lawyer says that they could arrest me again and do this whole thing again and say, again, it's too much, and run me through the system. If they wanted to do it, they could do it again, and the judges couldn't even stop it. And they could arrest me again and do it again. My lawyer says it's legal for them to do so. He doesn't think they will. And if they did, it would probably make worldwide news.
It's legal, but you couldn't really call it fair.
No, it wouldn't be just.
We talked to Doc Knapp, and he doesn't seem to think that there's any kind of problem like this going on, you know, where he is, in Sebastopol.
Well, not in Sebastopol and not in Petaluma.
So if you'd lived 5 miles to the west, probably none of this would have happened.
No, it wouldn't. And not in Sebastopol city limits.
Now, how did the sheriff have jurisdiction in Santa Rosa?
I'm not in the city of Santa Rosa. I'm surrounded by the city of Serrano, but this three-block area is county.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, this is county where I live. And Mr. Mullins has total authority here, and nobody else does. And hopefully he can't touch me anymore. Hopefully he's done with me.
You were able to actually accomplish something.
Most patients die out. I got through peer review and 2 years of this trial, and they delay it. They play games. They just really wanted to make it as financially expensive for me as possible. And as torturous as possible. And they do that to every patient. Most patients have to cop a plea because they are so medically involved. And
they're just physically unable to pursue it.
They're physically unable to pursue it. And so they have to be a criminal. They have to plead guilty to a criminal charge. And I refuse to plead guilty to a criminal charge. And nothing else. I wanted Mr. Mullins to put in writing, what did I do wrong? What law did I break? Tell it to me. So I had to have a jury tell Mr. Mullins that I was not guilty.
And you were completely acquitted.
Yes. And the jury told the judge that it was a waste of time.
A lot of us felt that it was wrong for them to be putting this medical patient through all of this.
And wasting all the taxpayers' time and money.
Taxpayers' money, wasting all the time of us as a jury to do that. It was a good 2 weeks that I was out of work, you know.
And I started to reach for my Disabled American Veterans cap that I had all my medals on. And I knew I could wear it with pride again because I wasn't going to wear my medals again. I spent it. And afterwards, the jury came out after talking with the judge and my attorney. And they came out, and one by one they came to me, and they hugged me, and they shook my hand. And as a Sonoma County taxpayer, they apologized for what the sheriff and the DA did to me. Eight of them did that. Eight of the 12 did that.
I think they were very upset at seeing their tax money being used this way.
Miscarriage of justice.
It was horrible. It was horrible for them to sit there and watch this go on for 2 weeks.
Okay. Mike Mullins suffers a crushing defeat in the Alan McFarland case. The jury publicly censures him for even bringing a case against a medical marijuana patient in the first place. But instead of dropping the charges against Hayes and Foley, he prosecutes the case to the bitter end. That's the big question for me. Why put these poor, sick people through hell for 2 solid years?
What drew me to the case? Well, it's because it's medical marijuana, because it's a great cause and it's a real issue that needs to be addressed. So. The patients really, really are ill. They really need the marijuana to survive. They really are using this medically. And on the stand, people were saying, with their open hearts, I would not be alive today without the club. I would not be alive today without medical marijuana. And I don't think that the media understands the gravity of the situation.
I became aware right away when Ken was arrested. And in fact, my contact with that caddy went back further, because I don't know if you remember when Brownie Mary was arrested up there. I introduced a resolution at the Board of Supervisors urging the DA of Sonoma County to drop the charges against her or give her a diversion. I then phoned at that time, the DA was Tunney, and I phoned Tunney and I talked to him and convinced him, between our declaring it Brownie Mary Day in San Francisco and the resolution of the board and my personal request of him, he did drop the charges against Brownie Mary.
That was pretty reasonable.
Yeah, he was much more reasonable than the present DA. When this present incident happened with Ken, I phoned Mullins up right away, before any charges were filed or anything, and told him, you've made a mistake. This guy is sincere. This guy is a legitimate person. He follows the rules. I worked with him. He runs a club. It supplies the needs of hundreds of people here in San Francisco who are sick and suffering. And Mullins just kind of wouldn't pay any attention to me. And then subsequently at a California District Attorneys Association meeting, I told him that you should drop the charges against Ken. And I told him right from the get-go, if you do this, I'm going to be testifying for Ken, because I do believe this is being done properly in compliance with 215. And that's what happened.
The District Attorney of San Francisco, a guy with the same job as Mike Mullins, tells him he's going to testify against him for the defense, and he still takes it to trial. Talk about obstinate. Although I'm beginning to think obsessed is a better description. We have got to talk to this guy.
You know, anytime someone's called the defendant, you got to be scared. You know, these people are looking at significant time in state prison, potentially. However, we knew that Sonoma County had voted very strongly for Prop 215, I believe it was 69% in favor. We went through prelim. We started to put on a affirmative defense at the preliminary hearing. And then the judge at the preliminary hearing, we went into chambers, and he basically told the prosecution, he told us two things. One, he'd have to bind us over anyway, and even if he didn't bind us over, he just put it in front of a different judge who would. And that means he'd let the case go to the Superior Court for trial. And two, he told the prosecution that they would never get a conviction in this case, that the worst that could happen to the defendants was a hung jury. So at that point,
that was the judge's opinion, Frank.
That was Judge Pasolacqua, Judge Frank Pasolacqua, who has been sitting on the bench, the second longest sitting bench in California. This man has seen it all. This man knows the law. This man's very smart. He's no liberal at all. And he basically told the prosecutor, you cannot get a conviction in this case. He also said on the record that from where he sat, were his words, Mr. Mullins was not implementing Proposition 215 in Sonoma County.
The pretrial judge, a judge, mind you, tells him that he's not going to get a conviction, and then publicly criticizes his actions, and he still goes ahead with the trial. What's up with that?
Beginning, Ms. Clay said that the case was about greed and money, and they started out testifying that Mr. Hayes was a big-time drug dealer, you know, who made hundreds of thousands of dollars. And my first question on cross-examination of the officer was, what kind of Ferrari was Mr. Hayes driving? You know, he just said, well, he wasn't driving when I came up. He was already in the house, right? What kind was in the driveway? Well, I don't remember. Or was it a Maserati or a Mercedes? And in fact, Ken was driving an old beat-up Mazda 323. And we went through, you know,
which what I drove here today.
We went through what were the signs of wealth. It turned out the signs of wealth were a nice crib and a nice changing table. And they had a 3-month-old infant. That was the signs of wealth. By the end of the case, they sort of dropped that whole theory that he was a drug dealer and agreed with the overwhelming evidence that he was caregiver to all these people. But they argued somehow through some technicality and loophole that was illegal. When we all finally rested, the jury applauded. I've been doing this 15 years. I've never seen that happen before. Then during closing arguments, when the prosecutor, at one point, I don't think she realized what she was saying, but she made some off-the-hand comment about we'll probably take about 2 weeks to deliberate. You could see the eyes roll. You know, these people, there was no way they were going to sit there another 2 weeks. As it turned out, they took less than 4.5 hours, which is a remarkably short time.
It took out
that long a trial, 7-week trial with multi-defendants.
And in the end, we got a full acquittal. It was unanimous. And afterwards, you know, they're hugging you and shaking your hands in the hall and were very, very supportive and thought that everything they were doing was wonderful.
Basically, it was a we don't like Prop 215 case. And what the jury said when we talked to them was they felt that once the police found the records, because remember when the police went into Mr. Hayes' house, he had 6 file boxes, big plastic file boxes, full of 1,280 patient records. And when the police came in, you know how many of those they checked to verify if Mr. Hayes was the caregiver? In 2 years, they checked 0, none. And the jury felt that when the police found those boxes, they should have stopped right there and not pulled plants and done a further investigation.
After his defeat in the Hayes and Foley trial, DA Mike Mullins worked in tandem with the Sonoma Alliance for Medical Marijuana to adopt a new set of grow limit guidelines for medical marijuana patients and caregivers in Sonoma County. These set a precedent as the most liberal guidelines in the state of California at this time.
What is your opinion of Mike Mullins' guidelines to his officers going to 99 plants? 3 pounds per patient per year, and 100 square foot canopy.
I think it's a good start.
It's a good start. However, it doesn't quite go far enough. And specifically, Mike Mullins rolled down the window yesterday and asked us what 3 pounds isn't enough. Well, Mr. Mullins, I say with great respect, that 3 pounds really isn't enough. That I request that you follow, if nothing else, the federal guidelines, which allows for anywhere between 6 and 12 pounds per patient per year. I think that that's a little bit closer to fair and real.
Quite a number of them do go through about 3 pounds a year, which it may sound like a lot, but if you compare it to somebody smoking a pack of cigarettes a day, that's 14 pounds of tobacco a year. So when you talk about a couple of pounds of cannabis, that's really not very much.
Do you grow all year round? You keep a steady.
It depends. If I'm going to be gone for a month, no, I just stop growing. Patients can grow for themselves, have a primary caregiver grow for them. And in Sonoma County, law enforcement also supports the idea of patient grow cooperatives. And that would be a group of physician-approved patients.
You'd register as that with the DA?
No, there's no mechanism for registering that. Basically, you do it, you comply with the law.
You just have something posted like you have here in the grower.
Right, right. And law enforcement does support that idea.
Well, I just want to clarify the 3-pound limit that you guys have agreed on.
is that 3-pound limit for the personal grower, or if you are a caretaker and can establish, you know, I'm growing for 4 patients, would they then be entitled to a 12-pound limit if they could,
if
they were established and registered as such?
That's possible.
In this case, I'm setting it up 3 feet wide by 33 feet long. So this gives me 99 square feet.
Each row?
Each row is 99 square feet. And everything inside of this 99 square feet is 3 pounds. Maybe 2, maybe 1. But
on the average for the whole quad, it would come out. So when each one of those represents a medical marijuana patient?
Each one of these is one patient, yes.
In compliance with the guidelines that Mike Mullen himself agreed
within
to.
Within the law. The law says 100 square feet, and I have 99.
99, that
so
1 foot carefully under.
So I am 1 square foot within the law.
So, how do you think it's coming along?
Not bad. I'm starting to see a through line here.
I just want to make sure we tell the patient's stories in the right way.
Of course. I just wish I knew what to do with Fred's song.
Don't worry, you'll find a place for it.
I know it's speculation, but would you care to say why you think Mike Mullins went ahead and, you know, dragged out this whole legal charade?
Mike Mullins is Captain Ahab, and medical marijuana is his Moby Dick. I've sat in his office.
It's personal.
Well, I've asked him, I said, don't you believe that marijuana has medical value? And he looked me straight in the eye, and he said, I believe that you believe that's medical value.
And I'm convinced that someday they will find out there is something in marijuana that has a beneficial effect on this AIDS virus, not more than just keeping the appetites up and allowing them to hold down the medication, but that's a big part of it, obviously. But I do believe there's more than that to it.
I think Mike Mullen's true nature is shown by his response to a very serious incident that occurred during the trial. At one point, Carla Claves, the prosecutor, went out to the firing range, and she took 2 human silhouettes, and she wrote my name on one and Nicole's name on the other, and she put them up, and she fired at them. That was not the smartest thing to do.
Indeed.
If she'd stopped right there, that's one thing. But she then took the silhouettes, the essential murders in effigy, and she brought them to her office and started showing them around the courthouse.
Wow.
It was very intimidating. I've never heard of anything like that in the course of a criminal trial, or civil trial for that matter. Well, in response to that, once the trial was over, after she had lost 2 high-profile medical marijuana trials in a row, after this incident happened, Mr. Mullen's response was to give her a promotion. So I think that shows how Mr. Mullen's, how strong he feels against medical marijuana. And I think he does feel it's a personal crusade, that somehow the voters were hoodwinked, and it's his job in life to save them from themselves.
Guess who I just got us an interview with? Sonoma County District Attorney J. Michael Mullins.
No way.
Again, I say to you, Way.
Why would he want to talk to us? How did you swing it?
I just called his office and they set up an interview.
I can't believe it. This is fantastic. But mark my words, he's not going to tell us squat.
Yeah, but what have we got to lose?
We met with District Attorney Mike Mullins at his office at the Sonoma County Hall of Justice. We wanted to ask him if he felt it was a mistake for an elected official to confuse upholding the law with upholding his own personal morality, and especially about those human silhouette targets labeled with the names of the counsels for the defense. But after providing us with a few minutes of prepared statements regarding the new grow limits, he seemed to get a little defensive and terminated the interview.
Under current law.
Okay.
Very good. He didn't tell us squat.
Hey, we can still use some of it. At least we provided him with the opportunity to respond. It makes us look a little more objective. You know, I'm aware that most of the cases that are brought to trial result in a conviction, you know, almost overwhelmingly, just in general.
Yeah.
And then most district attorneys, it's because most district attorneys won't bring a case to trial unless they're fairly
confident that they can win the case.
Well, that's the rule we operate under.
But what I can understand is so many of these cases, they lose so many of these cases. Would you care to speculate why a district attorney who perhaps even knows in advance he's going to lose would go ahead and bring a case of this type to trial?
Well, I think they don't concede in advance that they are going to lose. They're kind of, I think Mullins was pretty shocked by what happened.
In light of what would appear to someone to be something that you were going to lose from the beginning, did you really feel strongly that, in fact, you had a case against these people and that you were going to secure
Absolutely.
A conviction?
Absolutely. I wouldn't have tried it.
Right after 215 passed, Lundgren, the Republican Attorney General at that time, called an all-zone conference in Sacramento for DAs and sheriffs and chiefs of police, and I got in a kind of controversy with him in the midst of it, but it was me and a minority of one, and he told everybody that his approach was going to be that fight it every inch of the way, make people produce their medical letters or doctor's letters or recommendations, phone those doctors up, make sure that they gave it, scare them, make them worried about their licenses, and basically fight this thing tooth and nail all the way. And a lot of the DAs seem to me to be following that basic philosophy.
Those gosh darned Republicans.
I think it's wrong. It's not in compliance with the voters of the state of California. There's so much more important issues to spend our time and energy and money prosecuting violent crime, rapes, murders.
I don't think doctors should be afraid. I mean, so far the only doctors who have been investigated or hassled by the authorities have been those who have recommended marijuana to large numbers of patients. I might add that none of these investigations came because of complaints from patients. All of them were because of complaints from the police.
That case of Ken's ended up tying up a court for 7 weeks and a district attorney and clerks and all the court people and costing hundreds of thousands of dollars that could have been spent, as I said, prosecuting somebody who hurt somebody.
So we do need clarification of the statute we're all asking for. In the meantime, we'll all have to work through it case by case, and that is a painful process for everybody. Not only law enforcement, my prosecutors, but the patients themselves who really are patients and are firmly convinced that they need this particular product for their health.
You know, 100 of my friends never came back. I lost my favorite grower. He's terrified to speak to me. I can't even explain to him how he can be lawful about it now. And all he knew was that I came in with with 15 guys with their guns drawn.
You're still a criminal in their eyes.
My doctors have already established that I've lost a measurable amount of vision since this happened. I mean,
and the stress alone for crying.
Are you in remission, officially in remission?
It was malignant metastatic, and I have a hot spot over here in my sternal notch area. And my tumor markers are now coming out positive for the first time in 20 years, even though they're low and steady.
You wouldn't want to attribute that to all the stress that you've been going through?
I think it's just part of, everybody has a life, and I'm like any other disabled veteran. I live a shorter life in greater poverty, and I'll eventually die of my wounds. That's life.
The wonderful thing about this job is you will make somebody unhappy if you actually do anything.
Yes.
So that's just a given. We're going to have to go ahead and do what we think is right, no matter what.
During the trial, he was quoted in the press as saying that he hasn't seen any research that marijuana has any medicinal value. And my response to that is, it reminds me of the old Three Stooges routine, where Curly says, "I can't see, I can't see." And Mo and Larry say, "What's the matter?" He says, "I got my eyes closed." If Mike Mullins hasn't seen any printed research showing marijuana's medical value, it's because he has his eyes closed. He's refused to look at it. It's overwhelming. It's there.
So now we've got all this great material, but no idea of how to tie it all together.
I think it speaks for itself.
On a basic emotional level, sure. But if we want it to be popular with the general public, we're going to need some kind of humorous little gimmick to hang it on. Trust me.
I think that you have a criminal justice system that has gone one direction.
Yeah, it's like
a steamship. You know, you have, it's like the Titanic. And all of a sudden they see the iceberg and they go, okay, we turned the wheel. But the Titanic doesn't turn that fast. It takes a while. This is something that happens every time society takes a giant step in the area of like spiritual or moral or personal freedoms. You know, we had the Supreme Court in 1954, Brown versus Board of Ed, ruled that separate but equal isn't allowable. That you couldn't have separate schools for blacks and whites. And yet we're into the 60s, 6, 7, 8 years later, during the Kennedy administration, when he had to send the National Guard down to make Governor George Wallace let the blacks walk into the university. You know, and in the same way that Mike Mullins went after Alan McFarland and went after Ken Hayes and Mike Foley. You know, just because the law changes or the rules change doesn't mean the people change. Many people in law enforcement believe that drugs are evil, drugs are a demon, you know, marijuana is the devil incarnate. And so what if the law changed? They're protecting the people from that bad law.
We're going to have to go ahead and do what we think is right, no matter what.
So get the picture. Somebody might have misinformed you, or even at worst lied. You know, when people's jobs kind of, they'll turn Republican, they'll do anything. So
they follow Adolf Hitler if it comes down to that.
Well, we try to be honest with each other right now, and those who can't, we understand. But let's not stop the people who are helping each other.
The ultimate solution, I think, actually is to, and I've supported this, is to have the federal government determine that marijuana is no longer a class 1 drug, but a class 2 drug, allowing it to be prescribed.
Do you think that sort of goes to a loyalty issue? Do you go with the feds, or do you side with your own, you know, with your local constituency?
No, I think you have to decide with your local constituents what you want to do.
All right, I think I've got it. Instead of telling just the 5-year story of Prop 215, we can also tell the story of how we came to make this documentary. It's both self-referential and ironic. As opposed to all the live material we shot, we'll restage all these production meetings we've been having, and then, at the bottom, we'll put a title that says Dramatic Reenactment, just like on America's Most Wanted. It'll be a hoot.
Well, possibly. I'm not sure that I want to appear on camera.
No problemo. We'll just shoot you from behind or in silhouette or something.
Maybe.
People are getting tired of the war on drugs. And I think you really, to look at the situation and to understand why the police, the authorities, the DAs are against 215, you have to look at the bigger war on drugs. There's a lot of people making a lot of money off the war on drugs. I mean, think about it. We imprison more per capita than any other nation on the face of the planet. Now, somewhere around 75% of those are in prisons or jails or under the criminal justice system, under control of the criminal justice system, for drug or drug-related crime. The demonology, the war against drugs, has created more problems than the drugs themselves. Something like $50 billion a year that the government now spends between the state and the federal governments, not to mention how many billions of dollars a year are in the black market. It's very, very big business. And the way that we keep it going is marijuana. I think the government's estimates are that something like 15 million people who they consider drug users in America. And of those, something like 13 or 14 million are marijuana smokers. All the rest of the drugs together are maybe 1 million or 2 million people. And if the problem is only 1 million or 2 million people, all of a sudden people are going to say, wait a minute, why are we spending $50 billion a year on this? Why are we paying prison guards more than doctors and lawyers? It only works if you have people scared. And the way you get people scared is propaganda. Marijuana is evil. Drugs are evil. You know, Hitler used it with Jews. There's a boogeyman. There's the Jews. I can solve all your problems, but you got to give me the power to get rid of the boogeyman. Well, that's what's going on here. Drugs are the boogeyman in this country. The government scares people into giving them power, and eviscerating the Fourth Amendment, eviscerating constitutional rights, all in the name of the war on drugs. It's really a war on the people, a war on the Constitution, and it's big bucks. And medical marijuana is a major chink in the armor of the drug warriors.
Listen, I'm having second thoughts about the dramatic reenactments. I don't think they're going to work out.
What do you mean? It's a great idea.
I think they're just too irreverent for the subject matter.
Well, I gotta tell you, Lady Pamela, I hope you're not planning on this being a reverent documentary, because we don't have a big enough budget for reverent.
I just don't want anybody to think that we're mocking them. They have to go.
We're not mocking them. We're mocking us. Look, just let me shoot them, okay? Then, if they don't work, we just won't put them in.
Deal.
Do you feel bitter at all about, you know, about the way the system's kind of screwed up your life for the last 2 years?
No, I don't, amazingly enough. I have to put this back to Selma, Alabama. And there's Jim Crow laws, and you know, like, women got the vote 70, 80 years ago. And it's like reaching against individuals who live on a flat earth, and abortion's murder, and plants are evil. And there's no use for this. And God put something bad and useless here. And I say, no. And I feel like it's somehow, I feel like women got the vote. I feel like patients got a new medicine. And we just have to put people there in the justice system where they refuse to sit in the back of the bus. They refuse to drink the colored only water. Water's water. Let's make it clean for everybody.
And let's have it green for everybody.
That works for me. I like green.
Well, Joe Cable, here's to a job well done.
I agree, Lady Pamela. I don't think anybody could have done it better. But you know, I can't help feeling we've forgotten something.
Okay, yeah, anytime.
Said we had to change the law, so we tried to change the law. 100 little Lundgrens descended from on high, confiscate the medicine God made in a good supply. They said take what Eli Lilly makes and pay until you die. On your knees, Frisco.
You know, I would be the last one to sit in front of a camera and demonize all the cops, because from my experience, most of them have you know, understanding and tolerance beyond this, and they do and, you know, comply with the intent of the law.
And I just thank everybody for being so contained and being so truly loving and understanding. Here we are, forgiving these Nazis. It's outrageous, isn't it? You don't tear an old man's rotator cuff. What is wrong with some of these people? I'm sorry, but it's ruined my life.
Well, I want to say thank you to Michael Mullins for helping to mold this law into a way that I didn't think would ever be legislated so boldly. And so I want to thank him for helping make this somewhat of case law so that other DAs throughout the state will look at this.
Think twice.
Thank you.
we said we had to change the law. So we tried to change the law. They took our friends and cuffed them for hours making threats. They called them whores and faggots, the women and the vets. Hazel said, have we been arrested? Is it Argentina yet? Or good old San Francisco?
This makes me think of one thing, though. When I go into court, what the prosecutors argue about is that I have bias. And the reason they say I have bias is because I don't believe that adults should be sent to prison for the use of marijuana. And that's true. But my belief is if I might say to the jury, if they ask me, what do you think the marijuana should be legalized, I say, I believe it should be regulated for adult use, and that adults use it voluntarily.
Just like alcohol into that.
Yeah, exactly. And so, you know, that's really where I stand on this whole thing. That's why I defend Williamson cases and other cases like that, too. And anybody who needs to know more about this should, of course, go to my website, chrisconrad.com. That's C-H-I-R-I-S.
We'll put a chyron underneath you for that.
Well, look at you.
Thank you.
You have no doubt in your mind of the efficacy of medical marijuana from your own personal observation.
I don't think anybody who lives in San Francisco, and that's, I believe, why 80% of the people here voted for 215, anybody who lives in San Francisco knows somebody who swears that their pain and suffering is alleviated by marijuana. I think everybody in San Francisco appreciates this is not some powerful, dangerous, addictive drug, but an herb that needs some kind of controls on it, but that they should be reasonable ones that reflect it, and that for medical purposes, there's no question whatever harm there is in it is outweighed by the benefit.
The most important thing is that people should be allowed to do what they wish with their own bodies. You know, this country was founded on the idea that, you know, people were free to pursue life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness in the way they wish, as long as they didn't interfere with the same rights in others. And this is what I believe.
Said we had to change the law, so we went and changed the law. Election day was 4-1, yes, on 215. Compassionate use, that's exactly what we need. A little relief before we leave this lovely scene. San Francisco.
Incredibly safe. It has an incredible amount of use. And if this was allowed to come into a courtroom, as this becomes known, as people understand this, it really takes away from the credibility of the whole war on drugs. And that's why the government is so adamantly against medical cannabis. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense. Well, they have a vested interest in keeping science out of the picture and keeping the truth out. $50 billion a year vested interest. Well, thank you, California. I fought for you. Thank you for fighting for me. Appreciate it.
Amen. Keep them flying.
Hoorah.
Okay.
Did we get a release?
Oh, yeah, you still got to tell us it's okay for us to use
it. It's okay for you to videotape.
Thanks, and use you in the documentary.
To use me in the documentary. I assume you're not going to distort it.
No, we're not going to.
No.
Yeah.
This is the city of Elizabeth Moore. Kale, Joe Daly, Holly Brown, Guang Xing Cheng, Uncle Herb Kane. God, don't you love this town? This is the city of Harvey Milk, the body we're all a part of. This is the city of St. Francis, and sister, this is the summer of love. Oh, San Francisco, oh.